Grace and peace be multiplied to you through the knowledge of God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome. Today we'll be looking at Christ is the power of God. Christ is the power of God. Everything God is embodied in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Christ is the life of God. Christ is the light of God. Christ is the wisdom of God. Christ is the mercy of God. Christ is the power of God. Is the glory of God. Is the grace of God. Mention anything that is of God and we can dare point to you that it is in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the Lamb of God. So we're focusing on Christ as the power of God in today's teaching. The life of God is Christ. The wisdom of God is Christ. The power of God. Everything of God is Christ. Christ is God's light. Christ is the word of God. Christ is God's power. So anything we ever could imagine God is God is such in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. God is our light in Christ. God is our Savior in Christ. God is our wisdom in Christ. Christ, and this is why 1 Corinthians 1 actually tells us that of him are you in Christ Jesus, who is made unto us wisdom from God. So everything of God is embodied in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. But today we are looking at Christ as the power of God. Christ is the power of God at work in us. And 1 Corinthians, our anchor text is from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, that Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. Sometimes we think that the power of God is something abstract of God. I dare to disagree that the power of God is not distinct from God. It is the very being of the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Not some kind of abstract or software or some kind of something distinct or independent of God. The power of God is actually God himself at work. In any neighborhood, in any community, the power of God is Christ, the Lord Jesus Christ, who is the power of God at work in us. What a joy, what a joy. Everything God is embodied in Christ. Everything God is embodied in the Lord Jesus Christ. Like we mentioned earlier on, God is light. God is light in the Lord Jesus Christ. God is love. The love of God is Christ expressed to us humanity. And what a joy for the privilege we have in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. God's power is embodied in Christ. God's power is embodied in Christ. God's wisdom is embodied in Christ. God's love is embodied in Christ. God's mercy is embodied in Christ. So whatever we think about of the person of God, it is embodied in the person of Christ. God himself is embodied in Christ. For the scripture say, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifested in the flesh. So God's power is embodied in Christ. The power of God is the unhindered might of God. So we could define power probably as ability, energy to get a job or a task done, humanly speaking. But when we are looking at it in the context of the divine power, I could see it as the unhinderable might of God. That is the irresistible power or the irresistible might of God. That is the ability to get something done regardless of the opposition. So we could define the power of God as the unhinderable might of God. What a joy, what a joy. God is not distinct from his power. So let's not think that the power of God is something separate from God or is some being separate from God. The power of God, I believe, is just as the scripture says, it said Christ, the power of God. I don't think there's any more direct definition of the power of God is pointing to the very person of the Lord Jesus Christ. So looking ahead, God himself is the power at work in us, because sometimes we're thinking that the power of God is the power God is. But we go through the scripture, especially in the New Testament, and like in First Ephesians chapter 1, which we look at according to his power that works in us mightily, and also Ephesians chapter 1, that the exceeding greatness of his power that works in us who believe. And also we see Philippians 2:13, that it is God who is at work in us. So you kind of, I mean, it's all over the scriptures that you see the power of God at work in us. You see God at work. So is God different from the power of God that is at work in us? I believe that it's just the same very person. God himself is the power at work in us, the grace at work in us, the love at work in us, the light at work in us, the wisdom at work in us. Is just the very person of the Lord. So how this Ephesians chapter 1 from that verse 17-18, how great is his power at work in us who believe. And this power that is at work in us is actually the power God used to raise Christ from the dead. That is, to raise him from the dead and to make him sit with him in at his right side in heavenly places. So this power is very great. Say, how very great. I think it's the Good News Translation. The very great, because this power is just the person of God. It's just the person of God. I believe it's the scriptures. Christ is the power of God. So reading ahead in that Ephesians chapter 1, this power working in us is the same as the mighty strength which he used when he raised Christ from death and seated him at his right side. So this power at work, this is the definition the scripture is giving to us from Ephesians chapter 1, verse 18, 19. This power working in us, that is the continuous working of the power of God in us, is the same as the mighty strength which he used when he raised Christ from the dead and seated him at his right side. So this was the power, you want to call it the resurrection power of God, the power which God, and again, sometimes, which I think in the next slide or so, in this particular page, I basically just thought of it, that at resurrection, it appears God used God to raise God in the flesh from the dead. Because we say the power of God is just Christ and Christ is God. So God used God to raise God in the flesh from the dead, from the grave. It's mysterious because this power of God is just the very person of Christ, as the scriptures have told us. So the power at work in us, I'm understanding from scripture is that the power of God at work in us is very great, and we can tell that the only thing that is very great before God is God himself. So God is in us as power. God is in us as love. God is in us as grace. So this power at work in us is actually the very being of God. So God used God as power, because that power is God himself, to raise God on the flesh from the dead. And God now said, maybe going back again, if I could borrow from that scripture, Ephesians chapter 1, he said, how very great. So God himself, very great, is the power of God at work in us. We believe. Not everyone will believe, but we believe and we go from glory to glory. So this power working in us is the same as the mighty strength which he used to raise Christ. So at resurrection, it appears God used God to raise God in the flesh from the dead. Power is what you use to destroy an enemy. Basically, power is what anyone uses. Typically, we could say power also is the ability to, maybe, for example, you use money, value, power. The value is driven by the power behind it. So you have things like the purchasing power of money, the purchasing power of a particular currency. What you're trying to say, that the value that this currency can draw is dependent on the power that is backing it, or whatever the value is. So it is, power is what you use to destroy an enemy. God, Christ is God's means of destroying his enemy, that is the Satan and the kingdom of darkness. And 1 Corinthians chapter 1, for the message of Christ's death at the cross, this is the Good News Translation, is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. That is the message of the crucifixion of the Lord Jesus Christ. God causes the power of God. It might appear like a weakness before the Jews and the Greeks, because they are like, how can he be the Messiah and he's being hung on the cross? But that is the power, because the foolishness of God is greater than the wisdom of men. So for us Christians, also in 1 Corinthians 1, for to those who are called, both Jews and Gentiles, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. So for those who are called, we the believers, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God, the ability of God, the energy of God, the strength of God. That is the means whereby God uses to carry out his agenda, his goals on the surface of the earth and in the heavens. What a joy, what a joy. So Christ does not just have the power of God, he is the power of God. Like we mentioned earlier, that the power of God is not distinct from God. The power of God is Christ himself. So let's not think that, yes, we go through scripture, especially in the gospel, the Lord Jesus Christ, all power has been given unto me. So we think that, maybe all power was given unto him, but it's not the power. And now we get to Bible's progressive revelation, we get to 1 Corinthians, and we are told that he is the power of God. So he does not just have the power, the authority, the dynamis of God. He himself is the power of God. What a joy, what a joy, what a joy. So let's go through some scriptures about, we can't exhaust it, of course, anything of Christ is inexhaustible. So looking at some context of about how great, immense, the exceeding greatness of this power at work in us. The Lord Jesus Christ is the power, he has power over all flesh. John 17 verse 2, when he was praying to the Father, that he said, "You have given him power over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to us many that believe. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus, whom you have sent." So he has power over all flesh. So for us as believers in Christ, this is, I mean, we adore the Lord, we praise him, but he doesn't just usurp his power over all flesh and makes them go against their will. But the context I'm coming for is an intercession, especially intercession for our leaders, intercession for our loved ones, intercession. He has the power over them, but through our prayers, that power is actually activated. You could have power in a house, electric power, what have you, but if it's the light is not switched on, I mean, that power is probably dormant, it's passive. But the moment we start interceding, that power is now great and at work in us. So we don't use this power to manipulate anyone, but we in the place of intercession, we are praying to the Lord, so that the Lord, by his power, he said the heart of king is in the hands of the Lord. Also, he has power over all principality, power, might, and dominion. Whatever, whether in the heavens, on the earth, underneath the earth, the Lord Jesus Christ has power over them. He is actually the head of all principality and powers. Colossians 2:10 makes us understand. So he has been made supreme head of all things, power over principalities, over spiritual wickedness in high places, mentioning the Lord Jesus Christ has power over them. He's able to subdue all things to himself. Philippians 3:21, that according to the power which is able to subdue all things to himself. All things, not just humans, whether any element of creation, the wind, the sea, mention it, the angels, everything is able to subdue them to himself. And he said he's giving us this power, this authority that I've given you, this power, that in my name we do great signs, wonder, nothing shall alter us. So except we are lazy in the place of prayer, but if by his grace we are praying and interceding, we will see more of the power of God at work, not just in us, but also in our neighborhood, in our nation, over our family, in our places of work, in our countries. Power over the winds, the sea, and the elements of creation. Matthew 8:27. They were amazed that, whoo, what manner of man is this, that even the winds and the seas, the waves, they do obey him? Because the elements of creation, he created them. They were created by him, for him, through him, and they were created unto him. That is, they were created, that is, their agenda is actually to serve his purpose. So he has power over the winds, the sea. They can recognize him. They know the Lord. The Lord made them. They didn't create themselves. So power over the winds, the sea, the elements of creation. Power over the kings of the earth, the rulers of the earth, the presidents, the prime ministers, the senators, the queens, the kings, the mayors, the governors, mention it in the marketplace, the CEOs. The Lord has power over anyone that is in authority on the earth. Again, I repeat, it is the measure to which we are interceding. We are praying, like 1 Corinthians chapter 2, 1 and 2 makes us to understand that we, that first of all, I enjoy that supplications, intercession, thanksgiving and prayers be made for all men, especially for those who are in authority. As we are praying for those in authority, the Lord can use his power to carry out his agenda in that administration, in that country, in that nation. So we really need to be praying for our leaders. Also, power over hell and death. The key of hell and death is with the Lord. If I read from Revelations chapter 1, Revelations chapter 1 verse 18, that the key of hell and of death is in the hands of the Lord. Revelations 1:18 says that and to the angel of, no, sorry, I think I'm in the Revelations 1:18. I am he that liveth and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And I have the keys of hell and of death. What a joy, what a joy, what a joy. He has the power to send anyone to hell. He has the power, the keys in his hand. Power over the devil and his demons. In Colossians 2:15, I could read that. And also, I won't probably read Hebrews, but in Hebrews as well, that he, by the grace of God, tasted death, and that through death, he destroyed the devil. And Colossians 2:15, what I was quoting earlier was actually Hebrews chapter 2. But Colossians 2:15 says that, and having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. Let me quickly read Hebrews chapter 2 as well. Hebrews chapter 2, I think it's maybe around verse 10 or thereabout, that the Lord Jesus Christ, Hebrews 2 verse, it's not verse 10, it's probably Hebrews 2 verse, Hebrews 2 verse 14. For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil himself. So through death he was able to destroy the devil. Also power to kill and power to make alive. 1 Samuel 2:6, that the Lord himself, he has power, the Lord killeth and he maketh alive. He raised up and he can raise down. He also gives power to get wealth as well. 1 Samuel 2:6, the Lord killeth and maketh alive. He bringeth down to the grave and bringeth up. The Lord maketh poor and maketh rich. He bringeth low and lifteth up. He raised up the poor of the dust and lifted up the beggar of the donkey, to set them among princes and to make them inherit the throne of glory. For the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and he has set the word upon them. That's the might of the Lord. Power to bring down to the grave and power to bring up as well. Also power to make poor and power to make wealth. Also Deuteronomy 8:18, that you remember the Lord your God, that it is him that giveth you the power to make wealth, and because of the covenant he had with our fathers. So you can see the power, it's not just limited against the enemy, also power to raise up and power to bring down. Power to create out of nothing. Hebrews 11:3. This is just, I wanted to say powerful, but I don't know if there's any other word to use. Hebrews chapter 11 verse 3, it says that by faith we understand, power to create out of nothing. Sorry, I think that should be Hebrews verses 11 verse 3. Yeah, through faith we understand the words were framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. So he created everything by the word of his power. What a joy, what a joy. Power to create out of nothing, because he's the creator himself. Everything was created by him, for by him were all things created. Power that is light that darkness cannot comprehend. In him was life, the life was the light of men, and the light shineth in darkness, and darkness does not comprehend it. So this power is light. Actually, we know that electrical power is light. You know, when they say, oh, do you have power in your house? Indirectly, they are saying that you have electricity in your house. So, because power generates light. Power generates light, and lights bees, because there's a power behind it. For example, you hear what things like solar power, it's because the sun is giving us light. So this is a power that gives light that darkness cannot comprehend. What a joy. Also power that parted the Red Sea, Exodus 14:21. I mean, there's the list is unending about the power of the Lord. You go through the scriptures, we can't exhaust it, but we just brought a few out. That power that parted the Red Sea, that power is actually, that's the power God said is at work in us who believe. I mean, we adore the Lord, we praise him, that the power of God at work in us is the power that parted the Red Sea, is the power that makes alive, is the power that actually destroyed the devil. I mean, thanksgiving cannot just but start flowing from our hearts to bless the Lord, that God has deemed it fit to put his power, the power that parted the Red Sea. What a joy, what a joy. Power that fed over 5,000 people with 5 loaves and 2 fish. I mean, you go through the scriptures as well, in a few occasions that it was mentioned about how the multitudes were there, and yet through thanksgiving, I mean, the 5 loaves and 2 fishes were multiplied and they were able to feed. So what the Lord is trying to, I believe, part of the lesson there is that when something looks insufficient, God says, if you present it to me in thanksgiving, I have the power to make it more than enough. So, I mean, I don't know how 5 loaves and 2 fish will probably feed 5,000 men, except the power of God coming to multiply that which seems insignificant and makes it more than sufficient. Power that raises the dead, John 11:40-44, and there are a few occasions were mentioned in the Bible as well, in this case of Lazarus, that the power that raises the dead. And so the power of God at work in us is the power that also makes, if there's a dead virtue, there's a business that is dying, a marriage is dying, a situation, I mean, a distribution, God is saying that the exceeding greatness of my power at work in you will believe. We can activate that power of God, whereby we begin in the place of declaration, confessing, I mean, thanking God, worship, praying to the Lord. So the power at work in us is a power that raises the dead as well. Power that has conquered death. This is 1 Corinthians 15:54-57. 1 Corinthians 15, this is the power that has conquered death. It has gone through the region of death and has conquered death. He said, where is your sting, O death? 1 Corinthians chapter 1 verse 55, O death, where is your sting? O grave, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. So this is a power that has also conquered death as well. Also, power that framed the universe. From that Hebrews 11:3 that I read earlier on, the power that framed, that is the power that designed the heavens and the earth, and also the power that sustains the universe. So it's not just the power that framed the universe, that designed the universe, it's also the power that sustains the universe, that the sun is standing where it's at, it can't come any closer or go further from the earth, because the power of God is what is upholding it. It is the power of God that is making, that is sustaining everything in the universe, where every universe, the seas, they are not going to overflow their banks beyond where God allowed them to be. What a joy. And this power is the power that is at work in us. Power that upholds all things by his word. His word is power as well, which we will look at the means whereby the power of God is activated, the power of his name, the power of his word, the power of his blood. So by which he is able to uphold all things, that is upholding all things in the universe by the word of his power. Hebrews 1 verse 3. What a joy. Power that is able to save to the uttermost. Wow. Power that is able to save to the uttermost, that is to perfection, that is the Lord himself being the power of God at work in us, that is able to save us to the uttermost. also Acts 4:12, wherefore he is able to save to the uttermost that come to God by him, seeing that he liveth to make intercession for us. And if I read Acts chapter 4 verse 12, that there's no salvation in any other name but in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Acts chapter 4 verse 12, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. So that is the power of God that is at work in us to save, that I may know him, Philippians chapter 3, and the power of his resurrection, the resurrection power of the Lord, that we may know him and the power of his resurrection. What a joy that the Lord has given us this privilege, that the power of God is the power that is Christ himself who is at work in us. And Paul was praying, he counts all things but dung for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ. And he now said that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering. What a joy. And you are completing him who is the head of all principality and power, from Colossians chapter 2 verse 10. We are completing, this is what the scripture is telling us, that we are completing the Lord who is the head of all principality and power. Every one of them, they bow to him. And the Lord says we are complete in him, who is the head of all principality and power. So let's now go to some other context, that the power of his name, the power of his name. We go through Philippians chapter 2, that at the name of Jesus Christ, every knee shall bow, of things in heaven and on earth, that God has given him a name that is above every other name. Philippians chapter 2, I read from verse 9. And wherefore God has highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is God, is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The power of his name. We are saved by his name. We pray to God in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We give thanks to God in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. So we are baptized into his name. So you look at the name of the Lord, we are baptized in his name, we pray in his name, we give thanks in his name. What a joy, what a joy. Also the power of his blood. We are saved by the blood of the Lord. It said that the life of the flesh is in the blood, and the blood of sprinkling that speaks better things than that of Abel. We overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. So the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ also carries power. Blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Without his blood, we could not be saved. This was the blood that destroyed the devil. This is the blood that gives us life. We are justified in his blood. What a joy, what a joy for the power. So let's look at the power of his word. Ecclesiastes 8:4. Where the word of the king is, there is power. He said that in that Hebrews 1:3 that we read earlier on, that he upholds all things by the word of his power. That is, his word carries power, because the word of God created the heavens and the earth. The word of God made all things. The word of God is, we are alive today because we were regenerated by the word of God. We are being transformed. We are being sanctified by the word of God. So you can see the greatness of the Lord Jesus Christ, the power of his word. The word created the heavens and the earth, and the word of God is what God will always use to recreate anything that needs to be recreated. Everything was created. In the beginning was the word was God, and the word was God. So you can say the word was God, and that's why we say that the power of God is not distinct from God, because God himself is the word of God that is at work in us, which is the power of God. The power of his light, like we mentioned earlier on, the light of God is very precious, and light is precious. Light carries power. We said that light is there's a power behind every light, and the more the intensity of the power, the greater the intensity of the power of the light that will be showing. So the light of God, who is the light of the world, so this light carries power, because this light shines and darkness cannot comprehend it. What a joy, what a joy. Also, the power of his wisdom. His wisdom is also powerful. Remember I said earlier on that we could associate power to what gives value, like the purchasing power, they say, of money. So the wisdom of God is very powerful because it gives us value. It adds value to us. So there's the power of his wisdom. Through his wisdom, God created the heavens and the earth. The wisdom of God. Wow. We've done another teaching on that, that Christ has the wisdom of God. The power of his wisdom. We could say wisdom, I could define wisdom as what God will do in any situation. That is the strategy or the action plan of God over any project. That is the ability, what God will do in any decision making. And so for when God asks us to pray, that Ephesians 1, for the spirit of wisdom, he knew what he was saying, and also have revelation in the knowledge of him. The power of his spirit as well. So you receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Acts chapter 1 verse 8 as well. The power of the spirit of the Lord as well. Acts chapter 1 verse 8. But you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in Judea and in Samaria and to the uttermost part of the earth. So the power of his spirit as well. Ephesians chapter 3, that is able to strengthen our inner man with might by his spirit, that Christ will make his home in our hearts by faith. Finally, my brethren, Ephesians 6:10, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Finally, my brethren, this is a church rose that look. I mean, the list is endless about what the power of God can do. Christ has the power of God. But here is the Lord now saying that this is the final church. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. That is, we are conscious of the fact that the power at work in us is the power that can raise the dead, is the power that has the potential to create out of nothing, is the power that was used to destroy the devil, is the power that has power over death, is the power that can bring up, and that can is the power that can raise up, is the power that, I mean, is the fullness of the ability of God. And that fullness is just the very person of the Lord Jesus Christ. To be strong in the Lord as we behold him, as in a glass in a mirror, we are being transformed from glory to glory, and the power of his might as well. He is the supreme head of all things. Ephesians chapter 1, 21-22 is the God has made him the supreme head of all things for the benefit of the church. The supreme head, the head of the church, is the head of the new creation, is the head of all principality and power, is the ruler over the kings of the earth. Is the ruler over the kings of the earth, the president, the prime minister, like we mentioned earlier, the senator, those in authority. Christ is ruler over them. But like we mentioned as well, the more we pray, the more we intercede, we see this power of God is able to exercise his rulership over the present. If we don't pray, we'll just be complaining. But when we are interceding for the nations, when we are interceding for those in authority, God will be able to make them align to his will for the nation or for the land or for whatever area we're interceding for. He's also the Lord of hosts. He's the Lord of hosts, the field marshal of the heavenly host, of the angelic host, the Lord of hosts himself, the King of kings, the Lord of lords. I am the Alpha, Revelation chapter 1, and Omega, the beginning and the end, says the Lord. There is no beginning outside of me. There is no end outside of me. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord. The beginning and the end, says the Lord. The one who was, the one who is, and the one who is to come. The one who is, the one who was, and the one who is to come. The Almighty. The Almighty. The All-Sufficient One. The All-Knowing God. That is the Lord himself. What a joy. The Almighty means that he has all power. He has all might. What a joy, what a joy, what a joy. For by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are on earth, that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible, the Almighty Himself. By Him were all things created that are in heaven, that are on earth, visible or invisible, whether they can be seen or they cannot be seen. The Lord created in this Colossians chapter 1, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities and powers, all things were created by Him and for Him. Every one of them was created by Him and for Him. What a joy. So today we've been able to look at Christ is the power of God. I mean, this topic is endless. We can't exhaust everything about Christ being the power of God, but it's for us to appreciate the Lord and also appreciate Him for Him being the power of God at work in our life. He said in that 1 Corinthians chapter 1 that Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God as well. We said that the Christ is everything of God. God is everything. God is embodied in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Ephesians chapter 1, that He will open the eyes of our understanding so that we may know the hope of His calling and the exceeding greatness of His power towards us who believe. And this power of God that working in us who believe is not distinct from God Himself. If God is saying His power, this power working in us, and Philippians 2 says God is at work in us, God cannot be at work and His power will be at work in different area. We believe that God Himself is the power of God that is at work in us in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. We said that this power has power over all flesh. In that John 17 2 as well, He has power over all principalities and power. He has power to make poor and to make rich, to bring down and to raise up. He has the power. This power is the power that parted the Red Sea. This power is the power that has rulership over the kings of the earth. This power has conquered death. This power has the ability to make what is insignificant or what is insufficient to be more than enough. This power that is at work in us is also the power that God used to raise Christ from the dead. And we said that God used God to raise God in the flesh from the dead, because the power of God in us, we believe. Of course, the scripture tells us it is Christ Himself. So it's a mystery in the power that Christ is to us. And we said that there's the power of His name, there's the power of His word, there's the power of His spirit, there's the power of His wisdom, there's the power of His life. What a joy to what the Lord Jesus Christ is. For by Him were all things created that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible. Whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or power, all things were created by Him, for Him, and unto Him. And He says, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, says the Lord, the one who is, the one who was, and the one who is to come, the Almighty, the All-Powerful, the All-Knowing God. What a joy that this is the power of God that is at work in us, who is the very person of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's not just the life of God, it's not just the wisdom of God, it's not just the glory of God, it's not just the love of God. He is the power of God. Hallelujah to the Lord Jesus Christ. Christ is the power of God. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.